Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. Find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. My name is Tad Tobey. I'm president of the Coret Foundation and president and founder of its sister foundation, Tobey Philanthropies. I'm a member of the Commonwealth Club's board of directors and your chair for tonight's program. Tonight's program is part of the Commonwealth Club's series, The Principles of a Free Society, underwritten by the Coret Foundation. And now, it is my privilege and pleasure to introduce you to a very distinguished gentleman, tonight's speaker, Victor Davis Hanson, Hoover Institution Senior Fellow and author of the new book, The Father of Us All, War and History, Ancient and Modern. I don't know how you got that all on the jacket, Victor. Professor Hanson is here to tell us how war has created the world as we know it, how war will frequently change to suit our needs. He explores our conflicts from terrorist bombings on September 11th and Iran to ancient Athens and the United States Civil War. Victor was a full-time farmer before joining California State University at Fresno in 1984 to initiate a classics program. In 1991, Professor Hanson was awarded an American Philological Association Excellence in Teaching Award, which is given yearly to the country's top undergraduate teachers in Greek and Latin. In 2007, Professor Hanson was awarded the National Humanities Medal. Victor Hanson was a National Endowment for the Humanities Fellow at the Center for Advanced Studies in the Behavioral Sciences at Stanford, California in the period of 1992 to 1993. A visiting professor of classics at Stanford in the period of 1991 to 1992, and named Alumnus of the Year of the University of California, Santa Cruz in 2002. He was also the Schifrin Chair of Military History at the United States Naval Academy, Annapolis, Maryland, in the period 2002 to 2003. Victor Hanson is the author of some 170 articles, book reviews, newspaper editorials on Greek, agrarian, and military history, and essays on contemporary culture. He has written or edited 13 books, including The Western Way of War, Maxifornia, A State of Becoming and the Immigration Solution, A Better Plan Than Today's. His newest book is The Father of Us All, War and History, Ancient and Modern. The Father of Us All brings together much of Professor Hanson's finest writing on war and society, both ancient and modern. I asked Victor Hanson how he was able to produce all of this incredible amount of work, and he says, "I don't sleep at night." Professor Hanson has written essays, editorials, and reviews for the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the International Herald Tribune, the New York Post, and National Review. Currently, he is a weekly columnist for the National Review Online and serves as the editorial board of Orion, the Military History Quarterly, and City Journal, as well as on the board of the Claremont Institute. Victor Hanson was educated at the University of California in Santa Cruz. We got a BA in 1975, the American School of Classical Studies in 1978-79, and received a PhD in classics from Stanford University in 1980. Please join me in a warm Commonwealth Club welcome for Victor Davis Hanson.
Thank you for that very kind introduction. I saw somebody wondering, What's the UC Santa Cruz Alumnus of the Year? Are they mad down there or what? I've never been able to figure that out either. And believe me, the reception that they gave me was one of the strangest moments of my life. But I'd like to speak just for 30 minutes. We'll have 30 minutes of questions on the Greeks' tragic notion of war and how it permeates our own therapeutic society. The title is not original. It's from Heraclitus, the pre-Socratic philosopher's famous phrase that war is the father, the king of us all. And he meant that whether we liked it or not, war affected our lives daily. At least he thought that in the early 5th century BC. We have a very different view. A recent study showed that of all the historians at the 25 major universities, only 1% were classified as military historians. 1%. If we look at peace studies and conflict resolution programs, they number almost 200, and yet there's only 5 or 6 military historians, military history programs. This is quite odd, especially given the public's interest. If you look at Barnes and Nobles or Borders, you'll see massive collections on military history, but that has not translated into formal study of war. Why is that? I could probably adduce 3 or 4 reasons. I discuss some in the book. One, of course, is in the nuclear age, there's almost a collective despair of why would we want to learn about war when it could all be over in a matter of seconds? That led Lewis Johnson, the Secretary of Defense, if some of you remember under Truman, to advocate eliminating the Marine Corps. He said, why do we need a Marine Corps? Because war, as we know, it doesn't exist anymore. It's just a question of deterrence or not deterrence. So there is a note of pessimism in the nuclear age since 1945 that suggests that military history is superfluous. Another is, I think, that Vietnam had a lot to do with it. The tragedy of Vietnam, people, whatever side of that war they were on, they translated that angst or that anger from criticism of a particular war to criticism generically of war in general. Make peace, not war, etc. That had happened in World War I when the folly of the Somme or Verdun had created such an understandable loathing of all violence that a whole generation, many of them classicists like Gilbert Murray and Alfred Zimmern, had tried to outlaw war, and that led, unfortunately, to the appeasement in the late 30s and another war. And then after World War II, we saw that there maybe had been some tragic utility in war. After all, chattel slavery, Italian fascism, German Nazism, Japanese imperialism, and deterrence against Soviet totalitarianism had either involved war directly or the threat of war. But yet, I think now, again, we're starting to look at particular unhappy wars. They're all unhappy, but particular anger at a particular war has translated into war in general. That also, I think, explains why we don't study military history. And finally, it's the ultimate manifestation of the Enlightenment, the 18th century European Enlightenment in France, Rousseau, Voltaire, John Locke in England, that suggested that ratio, or logos, or reason, could explain natural phenomenon in a way that religion or superstition had failed to do, and that war, being legalized murder in some sense, was illogical, and that if people were erudite enough, calm enough, they could adjudicate these decisions without something so Neanderthal. This is especially true in our own time. The wealthier, the more technologically advanced, the healthier that we are, the promise of the Enlightenment is closer in our grasp than ever before. So we think that if we can have 500 channels, surely, or talk on a cell phone tonight to Kenya, then we can outlaw or get rid of something as barbaric or retrograde as war. All of that has conspired, in other words, to suggest that we don't study military history. Is there any reason we should? Well, there's a lot. History, the Greeks' idea of inquiry, began, remember, as one discipline only, military history. It began in around 440 with Herodotus, and he wrote what? The Persian Wars. And then it was continued by Thucydides, and he wrote what? The Peloponnesian Wars. And then Xenophon, a continuation of the wars of the 4th century, and Polybius, the Punic Wars, and on into Livy and Tacitus. There was no such thing as history apart from war. What was the reasoning behind the ancients' view? They were not relativist as we are. We, in our efforts in the 20th century, are loath to make judgments based on criteria, especially if they become offensive. There's sort of a moral equivalence in the way that we look at the world. The ancients said things are not equal. People are not equal. Governments are not equal. Cultures are not equal. And time and space is not equal. And if I could translate that feeling or that theme to the modern world, they'd say something that is very hard for us to accept. They would say that 1946 was not as important as 1945, that 1911 was not as important as 1918, that 1852 was not as important as 1864. In other words, that when young people with their entire lives ahead of them en masse commit violence, time and space is compressed. Technology, military revolutions, radical change in culture explode during these moments in a way that they often do not otherwise, and therefore they more justifiably warrant the historian's attention. We don't quite accept that today. So that was an ancient reason why we should study military history, that things aren't equal. Another, I think, is the idea of commemoration. Driving up here, you on 280, when you see a military cemetery and you see it's quite overwhelming, the number of crosses, and it overwhelms one. I was on the American Battlefields Commission that's in charge of the 52 cemeteries overseas, and walking in a place like Oham in Belgium and seeing 12,000 crosses, you wonder, why did these young people die? What did they die for? Do we appreciate it? Was Iwo Jima and Okinawa and Tarawa and Saipan, was it so we could watch Oprah and go to Walmart? And yet we used to worry that a lot of our young people didn't know what Saipan was or Tarawa. Now we worry that they don't know what Iwo Jima is or Normandy Beach. We have a collective amnesia this generation. It seems almost amoral that we have done so. I once gave a talk at UC Santa Barbara, and I told the audience I lamented the fact that there were 62 courses in Chicano studies and not one in the Civil War. Somebody got up very angrily and said, there is one. It's called Reconstruction and Gender. And I said, that has nothing to do with General Sherman. I am in great admiration of Harriet Tubman and Sojourner Truth, but believe me, Sojourner Truth did not do as much to affect the status of slavery as William Tecumseh Sherman in six weeks. But we don't know any of these things anymore, and I think that's somewhat a moral tragedy. And finally, of course, military history is didactic, and that's why I like to spend the last 20 minutes. There is some utility in learning how wars begin, how they proceed, and how they end, especially in this generation that believes that war is sort of archaic or repugnant and we don't want to study it. Reminds me of Margaret Atwood's famous poem, The Loneliness of the Military Historian, when she describes a dinner party and there's a guy there who studies military history and he's so creepy that people don't want to talk to him. Sort of like the idea, just imagine if we treated oncologists as pariahs because they study cancers, as if they love tumors. Military historians don't like war. I think most of them that I've known approach it didactically. They want to understand it with some idea of utility for the present generation, how to avoid them, or at least contain them or mitigate their effects, because they are a dour lot that don't quite believe they can be, unfortunately, ended. So let's go through this, and I'll try to think of themes that were in the book and resonate them in this third reason to be for a military history, that is that it's instructive for the present age, knowledge of the past, especially our military past. Why do wars start? Why do people get angry? Nations are just collections of individuals, and so people have disagreements. I was struck how many times when I was writing this book, I tried to collate all of the human interest story of suburbanites fighting, and I found 10 or 12 of them, people hitting each other over leaves, painting a fence, parking too close to a neighbor's driveway. All of these involved territory, but they were superfluous territory. They were of no value. It reminds me of the Greeks. Every single war that took place in Greeks, I think you could argue, started over borderland, number one, and number two, the borderland was worthless. So why do people do this? We're told that people go to war in our logical, rational, enlightenment age. They got to go to war over oil or bauxite or something. Remember when I was a student at UC Santa Cruz, they all said there were vast amounts of oil off the coast of Vietnam. And I would say, I don't think there's anything there worth it. But an answer to that question, I think, comes from Thucydides' history when he says that people go to war for honor and fear and self-interest. In other words, it's irrational. that your suburbanite beats somebody over the head with a croquet mallet because he does not like the idea that his neighbor is 1 inch on his property. Think a minute. Why did the British and the Argentines fight over the Falklands? I know there's rumors of oil there, but in 1982 there wasn't. I think the great essayist, the South American man of letters, Mr. Borges, said it was like two bald-headed men fighting over a comb. There's nothing of value. And yet, as soon as Mad Dog Mendez got on TV, the Argentine Marine captain, or general, I think he was, and he said, "Let me at them. I want to sink my teeth into the British." I thought, oh my God, he's evoking Lord Nelson and the whole reputation of the British Navy, and they're going to sail all the way down to that damn rock and fight it out. And they did. And we could replicate that. There's plenty of land in the Middle East for everybody. It's not about land. It's about honor and pride, especially on the Arab side. That seems to be true in antiquity, and it's true as it. I think it's that way everywhere. But just think for a minute. Germany today has more population and about a third less land than it did in 1939. Do you hear any German saying that we have to have Lebensraum? I mean, why did Hitler say that he had to have room when he had a smaller population and more land than Germans do today? I haven't heard any Japanese figure say that he needs a co-prosperity sphere. Just don't talk like that. And yet there was one time when the collective Japanese nation just was assured that they had to have a Asian sphere of influence throughout the Pacific. So there are irrational reasons why people go to war. But that doesn't mean they have to go to war. It means they'd like to go to war. Your suburbanite who is mad that somebody's leaf, his neighbor's leaves are on his property may like want to shoot him, but he usually won't shoot him or he won't hit him. And why is that? Is it because he's logical, because another neighbor adjudicates, because there's a suburban homeowners association that tries to adjudicate this? No. It's usually because of deterrence. One of two things. He thinks the other neighbor may shoot him if he tries something, or more likely, he will suffer a loss of reputation. It might affect his children, his job. The rumor will get out that he's crazy. All of those deter him. So if we look at all of our modern, this is the message at least from the Greeks, tell us. They have a word for epikairesis, a word for preemption. People preempt when they think there's more to be had, and they don't when they're scared that it could cost them more than it's worth. And Margaret Atwood's same poem, The Loneliness of the Military Historian, she says, people go to war because they think they can get away with it. Think for a minute some recent wars that are kind of strange. Argentine War and the Falklands, well, three things happened in 1981 and early 1982. One, a woman came as prime minister, and if you looked at the Argentine press, they were sure that this unknown Margaret Thatcher was not macho. Bad mistake, but they thought that. Second, they had one little measly minesweeper there, and the British thought as an act of caring magnanimity, they were going to withdraw this. And third, a couple of backbenchers in the British Parliament had called it the Malvinas. Let's discuss the Malvinas. And all that was needed to tell the Argentines during a time of popular unrest, a sinking economy, a dictator in General Galtieri, that the British wouldn't do anything if you took it. And with one fell sweep, you could get honor, pride, etc. If you look at this 1990 invasion of Kuwait, why would Saddam Hussein do something so stupid? He had plenty of oil. He was angry about that the Kuwaitis had snubbed him and had kind of bounced a couple of checks when they were supposed to help with the Iran war. But it was probably because April Glossby, our U.S. ambassador, said, you know, if you want to go into Kuwait, which Saddam had evoked in a meeting, it's not of a national interest to the United States. That was just an offhanded remark. But to Saddam Hussein, that meant he had a green light, probably. Why would the North Koreans do something stupid when the United States was the premier nuclear power and its main patron, China, didn't have any nuclear weapons, invade across the 38th parallel in 1950 in June? Probably because Dean Acheson at the National Press Club a few weeks before in a nonchalant way talked about a sphere of American influence and he left out Korea. And people in the communist world said, see, they're not willing to fight for Korea. I think we could play this game again and again. When Hitler was told that the British and the French declared war on him, September 3rd, 1939, 1939, he was absolutely dumbfounded. Why did they do something stupid like that? They didn't do it when we went in the Rhineland. They didn't do it when we went in the Sudetenland, the Czechoslovakia. They didn't do it during the Anschluss. Why suddenly did they do that? And because he was convinced that there was no longer a deterrent force to stop him. Same thing, there was a recent essay, I don't know if you saw, by a top lieutenant of bin Laden, who suggested bin Laden was dumbfounded about the reaction to 9/11. He said, why did they do this? They didn't do anything about the East Africa embassies. They didn't do anything about the USS Cole. They didn't do anything about the 1993 first attempt. Why did they overreact like that? In other words, whether we know it or not, we had lost that sense of deterrence. And that pretty much, I think, the Greeks would tell us, explain why these disagreements escalate to wars. That there are occasional bad actors who risk something that's sort of illogical for reasons of honor or pride, sometimes material advantage, and they have a good reckoning or a somewhat logical suspicion that they can get away with something at little cross, that it's worth the risk. Now, when these wars break out, there's two or three things that I think that are interesting about them. In the last 2,500 years, if they're conventional wars that between nation states with massed armies, the degree to which an army is so-called Western, it's not a racial or geographical term, it's an ideal. It's something that the Greeks and the Romans taught us about the organization of society. To the degree that a society has some sort of consensuality, they judge natural phenomenon by reason, they have a scientific tradition, they separate religion from the government, they have a notion of individual freedom, they define discipline with group morale, group discipline, rather than individual, the cult of the individual warrior. I could go on and on, but there are a number of protocols that explain why, let's be honest, if we're politically incorrect, nevertheless, there's a reason why Montezuma is not in Barcelona and Cortez can take down an empire of 4 million people. There's a reason why the Zulus, the most warlike and heroic people in Africa, lose in 9 weeks to the British. And remember, the British lost more soldiers in 2 weeks in the Boer War to come than they did in the entire Zulu War. More Americans were killed the first day in Antietam than were lost in the frontier fighting for almost a century. The British Army lost more men in 6 hours at the Somme than it had in 100 years of colonial fighting. In other words, this Western tradition is absolutely ferocious, and when it's turned on itself, it's almost suicidal. There's no rule that says today that the Chinese army must have hats that look Western. Saddam didn't want to wear epaulets just like ours. There's no reason that jets have to look the way they do. There's no reason that missiles have to be. I mean, the Iranians don't like the West. Why don't they make a missile that has wings on it or is square or round? Why do they always go back to these same designs, these same uniforms, these same organizations? If we had time, I think we could trace this back through the Renaissance, back to the Middle Ages, and back to the Roman army and even the Greek army, and our idea of brigades and battalions and divisions and companies and generals and lieutenant colonels all have ample precedent in the Roman army, and that most of the world, not through conspiracy, but because it works better than the alternative, have adopted, copied that, modified it. However, some people don't understand that. Some people understand that, and they have ways of checking it. There are people, there are things and people like Sheshwayu, and there is Islawanda, there is Little Bighorn, there is the Siege of Khartoum, other traditions who are wise enough not to engage in a conventional war with a Western power can check it. And they do it in three or four ways. We learn that from history. The Greeks learned that in Aetolia. The Romans learned that sometimes in Gaul, sometimes against Jugurtha and Numidia. So you have a Western power, and it's got this overwhelming capital. It's got superior logistics. It's got superior discipline. It can transport an army almost anywhere. And how are you going to defeat it if you don't want to play along those rules? One of them is asymmetry. Tends to be that when you marry capitalism to consensual government, life is pretty good. And that means it's scarcer, and it's rarer, and it's harder to give up. If you read the fourth book of Thucydides, he laments that very wealthy Athenian hoplites that were well equipped with sophisticated bronze armor, were trapped in the wilds of Aetolia and butchered by tribesmen behind trees. They didn't fight fairly, and he said this was a great tragedy, and the best men of Athens could produce, and they were lost in this skirmish, and it just bothered the historian. And he says this in three or four occasions. Tacitus does too about the Roman army. Our modern counterpart would be something like a U.S. Army captain, the beneficiary of $250,000 in West Point education, three-bedroom, two-bath house in, I don't know, Kansas City, emailing his three daughters about their homework each night from an air base in Iraq, goes on a routine mission. Ahmed, an impoverished son of maybe 15 children, where disease and infant mortality is rampant, happens to be given a cast-off RPG. He sees our captain. He shoots the RPG. It happens to hit it. It comes down and smashes Ahmed. In the terms of religion and morality and humanity, there's no difference between that loss. Human life is human life. It's absolutely equal. But in the way that each culture will define that loss, our captain will be in a paper, and people will read about his children who are not emailing his father, and we're going to see that all of that equipment, that $2 million Apache, versus a very small investment in one RPG, and people die all the time in Iraq. Not too many people with BAs are blown sky high or emailing their children in the United States. And the respective societies will interpret that in different ways. The same way as the Azteca knew that if they pulled down enough conquistadors, there was only 1,500 of them, they were all men of substance and property and reputation in Castile, they could demoralize that army. Same thing in the Zulu Wars. So there's an asymmetric notion of checking Western power. Another one is that the West is a construct. There is no monolithic West. The Ottomans had 20 million people at one time in the 6th century. The Muslim world was united. But the Battle of Lepanto, I mean, there were only three little Western states, Spain, the Papal States, and Venice. And the Ottomans' fleet routinely harbored in the bay at Toulon, France. And Europe was trisected by what? Orthodoxy, Protestantism, Catholicism. So the West has always been fighting with each other. I went back before, I had nothing to do for an hour or two today when I drove up here to beat traffic, and I went over to a library here in town. I was reading the transcripts of the debate about the Iraq War. It was amazing how France and Germany and Spain all were vehement critics of the U.S. decision to take out Saddam. There was no notion that this is a Western society, but there was almost unanimity in the Muslim world it was a bad idea. So, and that has been true throughout Western history. If you want to check a conventional Western power, get another Western power on your side if you're a non-Western. Third, these are consensual societies. I don't mean they're all out of the head of Zeus, full-fledged democracies, but there's a level of consensuality. Even Cortez, when he was fighting Montezuma, was sued in the process at Veracruz by a rival Spanish commander and had to address that lawsuit, this under autocratic Spain. So Michael Moore and Cindy Sheehan have precedence. If we could have time, we could read Aristophanes' Lysistrata or Euripides' Suppliant Woman, and you can see that in Western society, they're consensual, and a lot of the times they're fighting far from home, and these are deemed optional wars, not in the strategic interest, especially when they go badly, and there's anti-war criticism. That can stop a war very quickly. And we've seen it in Afghanistan, we've seen it in Iraq, we've seen it in Vietnam, and we've seen allies squabble, and we've seen the role of asymmetry. All of that are mechanisms to check conventional Western power. A couple of other observations about wars. So if we sort of discussed why we have disagreements nations do, how they break out, and what's the course of war when these conflicts begin, there's a couple of other things that I think are very important. And one of them is the nature of military error. We in the West, especially in the 21st century, when we have been so successful at mastering technology and lengthening lives and ensuring that the food we eat is so removed and the sewage that we produce is so removed from our everyday experience. Anybody that's a young person today doesn't know what it's like to butcher a hog or a cow. They just see the prepackaged meat. So there's a sense that everything can be done perfectly. So we go into Iraq, and all of a sudden there's a dust storm on the 11th day, and people go hysterical. They can't see, there's 24 hours, war's off the rails. Or we go into Afghanistan in October 2001, and R.W. Appel in the New York Times writes an op-ed that the war is lost. I think it was in week three, because we had paused outside Kandahar. When we went, when the insurrection started, the looting, people said the war is over with. When there was not enough body armor, when the Humvees were not up armored, we could go on and on. And then we had the WMD problem. We had, and the Greeks would look at us and they're saying, this is war. War is nothing but air. Think of all the wars that we participated in. They've all been sort of conspiratorial. We're not any different than anybody else, but we know our history a little bit better than we do French history or the military history of Burma. So let's go through them for a second, if we could. There's very suspicious things about Fort Sumner, as you know, you civil historians, about what that powder keg was like and whether they were supposed to fire on it or whether they were supposed to fire back or whether Lincoln really wanted that incident to develop in a full-fledged war. The Mexican War earlier, there was a Thornton affair where it was kind of a stage deal where we went across the border and we had we being Texicans and then Americans, a pretext for that war. Remember the Maine? That was the great cry in the Spanish-American War. There was a Lusitanian that was supposed to be a passenger ship, 1960, that was torpedoed. We know now that it may have been carrying munitions off the Irish coast. No need to go into World War II and the intelligence flap around Pearl Harbor. No need to talk about the Gulf of Tonkin resolution. No need to know that we had no idea that the Chinese were going to cross the Yalu River in November 1950. This is the stuff of war. And as far as the actual operational blunders, an up-armored Humvee or a lack of body armor pale in comparison to some of the things we've done in wars. I still can't believe as a military historian that we came up with the idea that something called a flying fortress was going to go over daylight at about 200 miles an hour and supposedly from 30,000 feet, knock out the strategic capability of Germany, and depend on a few 50-caliber machine guns to save this lumbering plane that had 9 crewmen in it, sometimes 10 and 11, and they were going to be fighting against the finest fighter pilots in the world in ME-109s and then Focke-Wulf 190s, and they think they could pull it off when the British had tried it and already had assumed that it was impossible. And we did that, of course, and we lost 25,000 Americans, 6 times more than the Iraq War on that flawed concept. But that's the nature of war, live and learn. And out of that, we learned what? You could stack formations to increase firepower. You could create drop tanks and have Thunderbolts and Mustangs escort them. You could use radio signals. You could use chafe. And by that trial and error, counter response, by 1945, the B-17s were taking a lethal toll on German society and industry. And that's what usually happens in war. If you take one more example, the Normandy invasions. We knew the size of the grain on the beaches at Normandy. We knew the currents. We knew the air temperature. We knew the wind direction. We had practiced that landing for a year in advance. It was one of the most successful amphibious operations in the history of conflict. And then what happened? The whole generation of American planners and chafe who so brilliantly imagined what it would be like and got an enormous American army on the beach and had served in World War I and had vacationed in France looked at each other and said, nobody told us that right near Omaha Beach there's something called the Bocage. Why, there's hedgerows. Now what do we do? And for the next 6 weeks, we sat about 4 miles from the beach and had 80,000 casualties. Until somebody came up with the bizarre idea of using B-17s as sort of dive bombers to blast out a hole for Operation Cobra. That's the nature of war, and yet this generation, I think, suffers from what I would call the disease of presentism, that we alone have encountered a problem, that it's not fair or shouldn't have happened or somebody's to blame when that's the nature of war in general. Let me just finish with some comments about how these wars end. I wish I could say that the Greeks And subsequent European history suggests that they can end by diplomacy, by adjudication, by international bodies. I don't think so. I can't think of a single war where one side said, let's bring in a third party. I can think of a lot of instances where somebody said, let's bring in a third party, or let's call it quits for a while. The difference between the first, that period between the First and Second Punic War, the period between the Second and Third Punic War, the period between the First and Second Peloponnesian War, the period between the First and Second Persian War, the period before World War I and World War II, the ongoing axis of evil people like the Iranians since 1979 or the Koreans since 1950. There have been periods, what the ancients would call a bellum interruptum, but they have not ended those wars. Think of the axis of evil. Who was in it when George Bush and his braggadocio announced that it existed? There were Iraq. We hadn't finished that war since 91. There was Iran since 1979. There had been a conflict. And there was Korea that was never really resolved. Who was not in that axis of evil? Vietnam, Germany, Japan, Italy, at one time arch enemies of the United States, who either we defeated or they defeated us, and the issue was resolved. Look at the Middle East, 1947, 1956, 1967, 1973, 1982, ad infinitum, because that war and the issues that are around it have never been solved. And so we have a classic era of many decades analogous to the Second and Third Punic War. Going back to that strange example of the Falklands, can you imagine if on day three the UN said, stop this horrible slaughter in the Falklands, we're going to have some patrol boats, they're going to put green dye for a green line, East Falklands will be yours, West Falklands will be yours, would they be living in peace? I don't think so. I think it would be like the settlement in Cyprus, where we have two sides in a green line, or the settlement in the Middle East. So whether we like it or not, war seems to end when the issues that started it are resolved, and that unfortunately is often when one side gives up and the other is defeated, and there's a particular kind of peace. It's very bad to humiliate and be ruthless to an opponent. It's very bad to be magnanimous and lenient to an opponent, but it is very successful to be A, ruthless, and B, magnanimous. Look at the difference between World War I and World War II. I think the Treaty of Versailles is vastly misunderstood. It was not harsh in reality, it was harsh in rhetoric. It humiliated the German people. It told them, you must pay. It was your fault. The fact that Germany inflated their economy and paid off with cheap currency, the fact that Germany was never occupied, the fact that Germany was never humiliated, the fact that the German army surrendered 60 miles inside France and Belgium, that was a very different story. That was a very dangerous thing to do, to humiliate an enemy without declawing them or forcing them to admit that they had been defeated. As John Pershing said to Woodrow Wilson, I brought 1 million men over here in the greatest logistical feat in the history of arms, and I finally cracked the German army, and they're running, and I can go all the way to Berlin. And Wilson said, but you wouldn't want to humiliate them. And he said, that's exactly what I want to do. In World War II, we did just the opposite. We humiliated the German people, we occupied the ground, and then we were one of the most magnanimous occupiers around. We included them in the family of nations, we promoted democracy, they were an ally, and we hit that formula in almost everybody's memoirs who was an architect of that policy, whether it was FDR, whether it was Harry Truman, or George Marshall, or Omar Bradley, they all talked in reference to World War I. And that's, unfortunately, pretty much how wars end. One side wins, one side loses, and the victor, if he's wise, is magnanimous and yet makes it clear to the defeated that they have been humiliated and the premises on which they started the war are no longer valid. That seems to be the solution to peace. Finally, is there any way we can break out of this cycle? And I don't think so. In the sense of outlawing war. Human nature remains the same across time and space. I once debated the head of the peace studies program at Dartmouth, and he told me that was not true, that because of increased nutrition and the use of video games and computers, people's brain chemistry had changed, and we had perfected better people than the Greeks and the Romans. I don't believe that. I think that's like saying that my grandfather's pump on my farm that did 3 gallons versus mine that does 1,500 gallons a minute is pumping something other than water. It's not. The water tastes today exactly like it did in 1890. The delivery system is much more efficient. War is much more efficient in killing people. So can we outlaw war? There's a great group of distinguished scholars at Hoover that believe that we can outlaw at least nuclear weapons. But as I mentioned in a very rude fashion the other day, we haven't used world nuclear weapons since 1945. But we've killed 1 million people in Rwanda with machetes. Would we want to outlaw machetes? These weapons are a tool. The problem are people. And so every time that we've had a dangerous weapon system, think about it. The Greeks were appalled that people would use missiles and kill good hoplite warriors without getting near them. The Hellenistic Greeks were appalled that people would use catapults. They were so unfair in taking down city-states. The medieval Christians thought that crossbows and arquebuses were horrific. Kill a knight? Poison gas, that was after World War I. Nobody should ever use that. Saddam shouldn't have used it. The Egyptians shouldn't have used it in Yemen. They shouldn't have used it in the death camps. So why do they do these things? Well, because we don't, nations are nations. There's no international policemen. They're sovereign states. But what stops these weapons from being horrific are two things throughout history. One, deterrence, as we talked about. Don't use a catapult against my city because my catapult's bigger than yours. Don't use gas if you're Hitler because Churchill has more gas than you do. Or there's a technological response. If you're North Korea and we can't deter you because you're crazy, then maybe we will have a system that will shoot your missile down before it takes off. Something like that. If you have a big catapult and you're not scared that we have one bigger, then we have earthen walls that we've developed to be invulnerable to catapults. So that cycle of challenge and response and deterrence seems to keep the peace much better than intellectuals like myself. Thank you very much.
Our thanks to Victor Davis Hanson, Hoover Institution Senior Fellow and author of the new book, The Father of Us All, War and History, Ancient and Modern. Professor Hanson, we've got a lot of questions today. I'll introduce myself. I'm Joe Epstein, past chair of the Commonwealth Club's Board of Governors. And we're going to start right away with this one about Thucydides, believe it or not. I think this is a timely question on the event of Iran's president's visit to the United Nations today. A two-part question. If Thucydides were alive today, what role would he be playing in society? Would he be an academic? Would he be assigned to a think tank like Hoover? Would he still profess that might makes right? Mm-hmm. Second part, what might his opinion be of Iran and its leader, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, and how would he view today's Iran in comparison to ancient Persia of the 5th century? Yes.
That's a big question. I want to be very brief so everybody can participate. Thucydides is the equivalent of somebody like David Petraeus. He was an admiral that was exiled because he came 3 days late to a naval battle in Amphipolis, and he was an intellectual. David Petraeus has a PhD from Princeton. He writes extensively. He wrote our manual on counterinsurgency, and he's a warrior. That's sort of what Thucydides was, Aeschylus was, Herodotus. They're not people like myself or the academic community that have no experience or don't participate in war. That's very different than Greeks. I think that's something that we should keep in mind. I don't think Thucydides quite said that might makes right. He accepted that people believe that, but a lot of the people who profess that might makes right, he portrays in his history, I think, as amoral. The Athenians are amoral in the way that they're portrayed. He doesn't have to make them that bad in the Melian dialogue or in the Mytilenean debate. But he chooses to, and there's a reason that he, I think the better way to look at Thucydides is he says, this is the way people are, they're no damn good, here's how you stop them, and I don't like that you have to do this. It's very depressing. Ahmadinejad, I don't know what he'd say about him. I know what you guys think about him. You don't know what to make of him because you're 99% sure that the guy really doesn't believe there's a missing imam somewhere. And he wants to take 30 million Persians and say, you know what, we're all going to paradise, and now the Persian Shia inherit the mantle from the Sunni Arabs, and we're the real Muslims. You're 99% sure that he doesn't believe that, and it's all an act. But you're not 100% sure. And that means that being loco and nuclear poker is pretty smart. So I don't know. We think we can deter him. The Israelis think they can deter him. But he's acting crazy for a reason. And he may just possibly be crazy. And 60 years after the Holocaust, I don't think the Jewish people can take that risk.
Professor Hanson, the war in Iraq is very controversial in many ways. Some say that by defeating Saddam Hussein, we actually have empowered Iran. Can you please comment on that question?
You know, I can't figure out Iraq anymore. Joe Biden, I went over to Iraq in 2006 and then again in 2007. Joe Biden, when I was there, had given a big speech that we had to trisect it. Remember Kurdistan, Shia, and it was over with. I just heard the other day, you did too, that he said it's going to be one of the administration's greatest achievements. So everybody adjudicated or changed their views on Iraq according to the pulse of the battlefield. That's not new. But Andrew Sullivan, he suggested we use nuclear weapons against Saddam. If it was Joe Klein, we got to take out Saddam. I could go left and right. William F. Buckley thought it was a good, great. All of them renounced that, depending on whether we won or lost. And now most of them are back where we started because it seems to be stable in Afghanistan. It was a good war, and now it's the bad war, and the bad war kind of ended up as the one that worked. So we really don't know. I don't know quite what to make of Iraq, but it's not going to be like Carmel, but it's going to be a hell of a lot better than Saddam. And one thing on specifically with that question, the conventional wisdom is that we increase the power of Iran. That's a pretty bad commentary on us, that we had to back a thug like Saddam Hussein to check another thug. But we've done it before with the Soviet Union. I'll let that pass. But it seems to me that Iraq in the long run will prove more destabilizing to Iran than Iran will be to Iraq. We've already done the deal with Iran with the Revolutionary Guard and the shape charges and them coming across the border. They're having a great difficulty, as we saw last spring and summer with a million people in the street, dealing with the fact that 24/7 Shia are participating in consensual government, talking, yelling at each other on TV that's beamed right into Iran. So I think in the ultimate scheme of things, if Iraq works, it'll be what finally destabilizes Iran.
Is the advancement of democracy a valid reason to go to war? Please give us some examples from 400 BC, yeah, as well as some modern-day examples.
I'd like to have anybody in the audience, I know we have a lot of distinguished scholars and intellectuals, if they can think of a democracy that came out of peace, I'd like to hear it. I can't think of one, not French democracy, not maybe British. Democracy evolved slowly, but there was a lot of violence. American democracy was created by war. Athenian democracy was created by war. Theban democracy was created by really a lot of war. Italian democracy, Japanese democracy. Whether we like it or not, it seems that there's a level of violence in the creation of democracy. Is it wise, as our founding fathers warned us that it was not, to find dragons all over the world to slay? No, I think I'll just say in passing, because I know that we have a lot of questions, but there's this idea that these neocon Jewish intellectuals, Paul Wolfowitz, Richard Perle, they got together with this kind of goofy Texan who had said he was against Milosevic, that operation, the Serbian operation, and he was a realist. He was a Brent Scowcroft, George Bush Sr., and he got in, and these crafty Jews kind of filled his head with, let's go fight. But we only fought two wars. We did not go through the 21 countries. And why did we fight two wars? One, because the Taliban had harbored the 9/11 terrorists. And whether you believe it or not, the Taliban were not Sunni Arabs who destroyed us. Sunni Arabs and the heart of radical Sunni Arabs, whether they were secular or religious, was Saddam Hussein. And we had 23... I thought very good resolutions to take him out. It was unfortunate the Bush administration focused on one. But there were other things, trying to kill George Bush, genocide against the Marsh Arabs, harboring Abbas and Abu Nadal, having al-Qaeda people in Kurdistan, breaking the UN resolutions. All of those were things that we could have discussed had they not tried to focus on one.
So democracy then, Professor Hanson, can and is often created from conflict. Is that correct?
Yes, it is. And the reason that I wasn't very good on answering that. The reason that people thought that it would be good to take out Saddam and put a democracy is there is some evidence that democracies, while they are ferocious war makers and they can be enormously belligerent to non-democracies, are very unlikely to attack one another. The most prominent is Syracuse and Athens, and maybe Mantinea, but 1812 parliamentary Britain and the United States, but usually they don't attack each other. So the idea is you get a critical mass of democracies in the world. We have more today than we've ever had. I think it's 181. The likelihood of these democracies. And I think that's a very logical thing. If you think of nuclear weapons, I think this administration's a little bit wrong, because I don't lose any sleep that France has them or Britain has them. I lose a lot of sleep that North Korea has them and Pakistan has them. The problem isn't nuclear weapons per se. It's good not to have very many people. But if Japan goes nuclear, that's not the disaster that Iran will be. So democracies have a positive role to play in the world, and they lessen tensions, and the more the better, I suppose.
You are listening to the Commonwealth Club of California's radio program, and our guest today is Victor Davis Hanson, Hoover Institution Senior Fellow and noted author, who is discussing war and its impact on society. Does war have an overall positive or an overall negative impact, would you say, on the development of our society?
Well, I don't like the idea of war. I would rephrase that as wars. Particular wars have had utility. I don't know how we would have stopped Hitler without a war. I know Pat Buchanan and others believe that we could have talked him out of it or something, but I don't think there's any evidence for that. I think the moment he got into Poland, this idea that he was radicalized by the war and only went to the final solution, that's not true. He was targeting Jews on September 2nd, the moment he got into Poland. I don't know how you would have stopped him without force, unless you could have deterred him and made him. I don't know how. World War I is more problematic, but there was a difference between the Kaiser's society and what he envisioned for Europe and what the democracies in France and Britain did. So there are wars that eliminate things like slavery and Nazism. Other wars, the War of 1870, a lot of the Napoleonic Wars, I'm not sure the Falklands War, that was, I think, important to teach people not to redraw borders, but the answer to that question depends on the circumstance of the particular war. War can be legalized murder, or it can be a last desperate act to stop somebody who wants to kill a lot of people. One last thought. Most of the people in the 20th century which saw the greatest amount of corpses in wars in the history of conflict, more people were killed in violence in World War II, World War I, and these horrible things after than any other century we think of in history. And yet, you could probably make the argument that more people died off the battlefield in the 20th century than on. If you look at the 30 million that Stalin killed, the 6 million that Hitler, we can add in Pol Pot and all of those things. So sometimes not stopping somebody who's exterminating people. I think you could have saved 1 million people in Rwanda had we acted very quickly and smartly. I think that for all the problems in the Serbian war, Milosevic was stopped and he would have killed a lot more than the 150,000 that he did.
Well, here's sort of a $64 question, I would think. How would you define victory or winning in modern war? With nuclear stalemates, don't most conflicts just end with no clear winner?
Yeah, I don't like to think modern war, we come to the end of history, things change because of a particular weapon. There will come a time, not in my lifetime, when there will be sophisticated lasers or there will be chemical reactions that reverse nuclear fusion or something that will make nuclear weapons a particular weapon and not the only weapon. I think it'll be a very dangerous time, but that will be a period in the human experience. So that would mean that victory is victory, whether the Greeks or us. Victory simply means imposing your will on an enemy so that he accepts your political objectives. That's it. And to the degree that you can do it today, it works, and to the degree you can't, nuclear politics complicate the matter, but they don't make the idea of victory obsolete, seems to me. Saddam Hussein lost that war. He's no longer there. He'll never come back. He lost. Very clear. It's very clear to me that we lost Vietnam. We're not going to go back in there and try to have a democratic Korean-like authoritarian government that could evolve into something better. We lost that war. They won. We lost. And it seems to me that victory is very much alive, but the problem is that in a postmodern, sophisticated Western society, the price of victory is no more costly than what we paid at Antietam or Shiloh or in the past, but for our society, it's more abhorrent than ever because life is life and knowledge and logic. It's so more sophisticated that it makes it more complicated, but it's not obsolete.
There's quite a few questions on the change and advancements in war weaponry, technology. Please discuss how technology has made a difference in conducting modern day war.
All technology has done is made war more lethal, but I should be very careful about that. More lethal, but somehow a million people were killed in Rwanda with machetes. And since 1945, nobody's died from a nuclear bomb. So if you have a will, there's going to be a way. But mostly, modern technology has closed the window so that decision-making, doubt, suspicion, uncertainty have been collapsed through sophisticated satellite imagery or electronic intelligence so that you have to make decisions like this. And we don't have these long, drawn-out periods of uncertainty. And when we do fight, it's much, much more expensive. We're getting to the point where to equip a U.S. soldier is about $20,000 in equipment. And so that armies are actually getting smaller, air forces are getting smaller, navies are getting smaller, but they're getting more lethal at the same time. But again, these are manifestations of human nature. Human nature hasn't changed. It's just that it has to react in different ways. And all of these things are cyclical. They can be reversed. There's no reason that we always are going to have a continuum. We can have a large depression, a recession. If some of you believe in global warming, some of you believe in nuclear winter, whatever it is, it can happen. But what we can be certain won't change is human nature. And that's why I think military history is so valuable.
Professor Hanson, I was struck by your comments in the Father of Us All in discussing the evolution of modern weapons that the U.S. and Western allies have not really found a means of producing cheaper weapons. Yes. And you talk about terrorism, how they sacrifice lives for death, and whereas we spend a lot of money on weaponry to accomplish the same thing.
Yeah, well, I think if you were to be a Western laboratory would say, how can we create the perfect robot and program it to go into a hostile neighborhood undetected and then at the appropriate microsecond blow up? And that would cost us about $1 billion in R&D and then probably $1 million in unit. Al-Qaeda says, I get somebody whose life is not very optimistic anyway, and I can, his brain is far more sophisticated than any computer the West can make, and I can put a bomb on him and he can pass through a sentry and he can blow up a lot of people. So what we're seeing is that the non-Western world is able to trump or at least nullify Western technological advantage based on one premise, that we are living to die, and I mean, they're dying to live. We in the West are dying to live, they're living to die. Meaning they, the small cadre of suicide bombers. So sophisticated technology can be trumped if people cross a Rubicon and say that my life means nothing. And once you cross that, the human body and the human brain are so sophisticated they're a match for any computer, as we're learning.
Several questions were submitted on Israel. I'll see if I can get to maybe one or two of them. Israel was accused of using disproportionate force when it went to war in Gaza in December of 2008. In the first Gulf War, the United States used, quote-unquote, overwhelming force, part of the Powell Doctrine, to win quickly and to minimize casualties. Can you compare the two, or is there a comparison?
Well, I've never heard this term before, the 2006 war, disproportionate. I mean, when you go to war and somebody said, let me at them, in the case of Hamas, they said, let me at them. We're shooting these rockets. So there was a war. And then the point of war is to get it over as quickly as possible and force the enemy to accept your premises. In the case of Israel, for all of our Western criticism, they won that war. The war was over whether Hamas could indiscriminately shoot missiles. That's how the Israelis termed it. Maybe you can disagree with that. But they said, we're going to go to war, and then they're not going to do it anymore. More or less. And they're not doing it right now. In other words, most people in the Western world said that was disproportionate are the Israelis' laws. The Israelis basically said, we established a precedent. If they want to shoot missiles at us, we will inflict billions of dollars of damage every time they decide to do it. And if you look at the calculus, we're going to win that calculus. We're willing to pair it up with 8 or 10 people killed for a while, and then we're going to, all hell's going to break loose about every 3 years, and pretty soon they'll stop. And that's their rationale, and I think that there's historical precedent that it will work. And so I don't understand what disproportionate, an atomic bomb disproportionate compared to what? A million-man invasion of the Japanese mainland? Was Okinawa disproportionate? I don't know. This is what war, when you're in a war, it's legalized murder, basically. And so the point is to use as much force as you can to stop the enemy and have him cease and desist. And if you want to drag it out, you'll get something like Vietnam or Afghanistan as we are now, or Iraq. But it seems to me the quicker and the more decisive you use force, the more humane it is in the long run. Otherwise, you shouldn't go to war if you're not going to do that.
There's a new book out by Dan Senor called Startup Nation. It talks about one of the key differences between Israel's defense forces and the U.S. or Western military. And one of the key differences is the encouragement in the Israeli defense forces to question orders given by superior officers.
Yeah, I've talked to a lot of people in the Israeli army, and to be candid, I don't see that much difference. It's very similar to the American army. The two times I've been in the Iraq war and talk, I was just amazed at the way captains talk to majors and majors talk to lieutenant colonels and lieutenant. That war was won by colonels. It was not won by generals. The surge, it was a colonel's war, and they were arguing every night with lieutenant colonels, and there was give and take, and that's pretty much the way the American military has always worked. And it's a pretty open society. As somebody who taught 21 years on the university campus, I think if you are in Iraq and you say, I think this war sucks and we're going to lose and it's stupid, a colonel will say, let's discuss it. You may be right. I think if you're on the Stanford campus in 2004 and you get up and say, I think the war is great and we're going to win it, you're going to be shouted down and you're not going to have any free speech. So my experience is there's more free speech in the military than there is on a university campus.
Could you please explain the emergence of counterinsurgency warfare and its role in winning the hearts and minds of our enemies?
Yeah, the idea, remember, it's counterinsurgency good, counterterrorism bad. The old idea, we go kill all the terrorists no matter what they are and do so much damage that the people will go to the terrorists and say, hey, don't do it. Look, don't do it. Well, that's passé now because we're a sophisticated, globalized society and it'll be counterproductive. That the American people, when they see another highway of death, they'll say, uh-oh, I didn't sign on for that. So what we do now is we try to, before we have defeated and humiliated the enemy, we try to win their hearts and minds and say, we're bringing you water and we respect your tribal customs and therefore you're to turn on the enemy rather than just, and I think there's some logic to it given the nature of American society today. A lot of people make fun of counterinsurgency, and they say, oh, we're coddling the enemies, but they would be the first people to bail out on a war when we used a counterterrorism or conventional strategy of inflicting collective punishment on the enemy. I don't think that's, in a postmodern society, that's very difficult to do.
Well, we have so many more wonderful questions, but unfortunately, not just enough time to do more than this last one here. If war lies within our society and the history of war is so clearly entrenched in our society, do you think there is hope for a peaceful world?
I do. I do if we accept certain premises. A, humans are no damn good. B, that peace is kept through internal eternal vigilance and requires a modicum of sacrifice during peace so that you don't pay a greater price during war. And that would mean that we try to help people, we be humane, we reach out, we really emphasize diplomacy, we have a lot of foreign aid programs. All of these will be effective, but we do keep 12 carrier groups. And we do understand that there are going to be people who are going to interpret our magnanimity, $15 billion in AIDS relief in Africa, national outrage over Guantanamo, all of these things that consensual societies do, they're not going to be impressed. They're not going to be impressed that our president's middle name is Hussein, or he claimed in Cairo in June of last year that the Islamic world was responsible for fostering the Renaissance and the Enlightenment. That's not going to register. They're going to interpret that as weakness or decadence or lack of confidence in one's culture. Not everybody, but a few. And for those few who start wars, and those are usually the people who do, then you have to be vigilant and hope that you can deter them. Wars start and violence ensues and people die when utopians suggest that they've outsmarted human nature and they've reached a higher level of evolution and therefore they need not be Neanderthals and have military force anymore. Every time that happens, it's an invitation to disaster. And on that bleak note, thank you.
Thank you.
Our thanks to Victor Davis Hanson, Hoover Institution Senior Fellow and author of the new book, The Father of Us All, War and History, Ancient and Modern. And we also thank our audiences here on radio, television, and on the Internet. Today's program has been underwritten by the Corrett Foundation as part of the Principles of a Free Society series. I'm Joe Epstein, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, where you are in the know, is adjourned. Thank you.